Everybody to the Martin Siegel Theater Center here at the Goethe Center CUNY, and for some of you who were here all day already, this is just a continuation of a day on Marathon Theater, but also it was a marathon day for the Siegel Center. We very rarely have all day events, but we were able to, with Jonathan's help, to show almost 10 hours, 12 hours of the Peter Stein work on Faust 1 and 2, which is one of seven works he focused on in his truly impressive, interesting, and I think inspiring book on a marathon theater. It got the George Nathan Award, which Jonathan got the second time, which is a very rare thing in the life of any writer who's a professor of theater and writes for the theory of theater. So congratulations, and he's a part of the CUNY family teaching at Hunter College and has been with us for many other events, Yale Neck and many others. So welcome. With us tonight also is John Muse from the University of Chicago. John, you will talk with him about the book. He is a specialist on microdrama. Under 5 minutes?
Under 20 minutes.
Under 20 minutes. And he wrote a review that Jonathan really liked a lot, so we thought that would be a good combination. Unfortunately, as you might have heard today, there was at the marathon in Boston, you know, bombs that went off, two people died, over 20 injured. So it's one of these strange coincidences that sometimes happens in the world. And so my name is Frank Henschke. I'm the director of programs and the executive director of the Siegel Theater Center. And we do bridge between academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And of course, Faust, Peter Stein, and the idea of marathon theater is something that is a brilliant combination. And we are honored, you know, to have you here. And thank you all for coming and taking the time to listen to us. If you have a cell phone, just take it out for 1 second and make sure it's power off or the sound is off, especially for those panelists when we have wireless mics. And we will have Jonathan give an introduction about 20, 30 minutes on his work, on the book, then both of them will talk about the book. John will speak with Jonathan and then there's time for questions and answers. We also will have a little microphone, not only so we hear it better, but we're also recording it, and the evening is live streamed, so people around the world actually are right now listening to us and are here with us. So our real audience is actually very, very large and much bigger than this. Jonathan, thank you.
Okay, Forrest, do I have to do anything? Okay, thank you. So thank you for coming, everybody. I appreciate you being here, and if you've been here all day, I really appreciate that. I admire your fortitude and your heart in sitting through whatever amount of time you did for that. So I just want to talk about what gave me the idea for this book. The idea for this book actually came to me during Faust 1 and 2. This production took place in the West German town of Hanover in 2000 at a World's Fair called Expo 2000. It was 2 days of constant theater. Faust 1, 7 hours on Saturday. Faust 2, 14 hours on Sunday. 10 intermissions over the 2 days. Terrible concrete benches outside of the hall, which was a kind of an airplane hangar that you just walked outside of and had to find some degree of comfort during sometimes 15-minute pauses and sometimes an hour meal break. The audience was 430 people, and I was there by myself, and I chatted with people. And there I was chatting with different people and actually getting to know them over 10 intermissions. I chatted with this one woman who was there with her granddaughter. Every single German studies Faust in grade school. This is like Catcher in the Rye for us as Americans. I fell into this incredibly, I thought, interesting conversation with them, because the granddaughter, who was 14 years old, was talking about Mephistopheles and television, how the triviality of television and the trivialization of television was kind of like the force of Mephisto. And I'm sitting there thinking, what a lovely moment this is. And I had a big deja vu. I remembered a conversation that I had in the 1980s when I was at BAM seeing the Mahabharata. A marathon theater event that was 11 hours at BAM before Fort Greene was a gentrified area. Also talking to strangers on the floor of the BAM lobby, which was then called the Majestic Theater, not the Harvey. Hundreds of people gathering together in the floor of the theater during the intermissions because they were afraid to go out and explore Fort Greene. Talking to strangers, once again. This impromptu community that formed apart from the theater, and I realized that day at Faust that I really had sort of been here before. It was that deja vu feeling. I remembered some other things that I'd seen. I remembered Nicholas Nickleby, which I saw during college. My mother sent me a plane ticket. She was living in London, sent me a plane ticket, said, come on over during Christmas break, 1980. And then she handed me this theater ticket and said, go see this, I think you'll like it. And that was a very, very important event for me for reasons I couldn't articulate then, because I didn't study theater yet. I just knew that it imprinted very, very strongly with me and didn't understand why. I saw the Mahabharata. This is a Mahabharata, the Peter Brook work. I saw Lepage, Robert Lepage's Seven Streams of the River Ota, which was a piece about Hiroshima and about other things, also stayed with me. You probably know Angels in America. Angels in America was a 7-hour, two-part drama, which appeared on Broadway, kind of a shocking thing. And then the following year, there was another marathon production on Broadway called The Kentucky Cycle by Robert Schenken, which is a series of stories in Appalachia. Very, very unusual for these things to occur on Broadway, but Nicholas Nickleby kind of opened that up. And I thought, do these things have anything in common other than their length? And I, at first, didn't think so. I dismissed the idea in my head at first, because I thought, what a cheesy idea to link works of the imagination, length, you know? What does length mean? Length alone means nothing. That's the first thought that went through my head. What does size matter? We live in depending on how you look at it, the romantic age or the post-romantic age, where an artwork makes its own rules. The only question we ask is, how long does a work need to be? It's as long as it needs to be, if it's good, and as short as it needs to be, no longer and no shorter. So we all know that there are terrible long works, right? And there are terrible short works. Length alone tells you nothing. Not only that, but we live in a time when publicists use words like epic and marathon as empty gimmicks in order to sell us things that they think or want us to believe are massively important, which we then go see and realize are just as trivial as anything that might be 5 minutes long or 10 minutes long. Then I started to think these things over, and I realized that no, there were reasons why these particular productions fit together meaningfully. For one thing, these productions were endurance feats for the audience as well as the actors. Sometimes these productions that I'm talking about held me in my seat so strongly that I didn't want to go home even after 8 hours. When Nicholas Nickleby ended, I remember feeling sorry that that world had evaporated at the end of the theatrical production. And that didn't mean that I wasn't as achy and creaky as the next person who had sat in those seats all those hours. It meant that something had happened that made the time shorter and more meaningful. I also think that these works offer a rare experience in the media era, and that is sustained meditation. We have fewer and fewer opportunities for sustained meditation because of the way that we have thrown so many resources into abbreviating everything. And Walter Benjamin once said that that's the mark of the modern era, is that we now no longer work at anything that can't be abbreviated. That's sad. And I think it leaves a hole in our lives. Sociologists talk about a phenomenon called hurry sickness, which I think doesn't even need to be explained to anybody who lives in our time. The way that we rush through everything in life, this mad rush to what? I don't even think any of us could explain it. But in New York, you know, it's endemic and it's addictive. We keep on checking our apparatuses and rushing off to the next thing. Furthermore, we do this more and more in front of screens. We do it alone in front of screens, one screen or another. We can relax in front of screens, but we can also do some of our rushing, in front of screens. And so these screens have now become portable, so our epidemic ADHD that we all, suffer from, as it were, is now something we can take along with us. But this is the thing about a theater event, is that it offers relief from that also, because theater is some place that you have to go to, get dressed and go elsewhere to, and sit together with however many hundreds of other people and have an experience. These marathon theater events tend to take place in unusual places. I love that. There was a Peter Stein event at Expo, this Faust event, but Peter Stein also did a production on Roosevelt, on Governor's Island, a couple of years ago. It was nothing like Faust. It was a bit of a lazy production of a Dostoevsky novel, but that didn't matter. The journey to Governor's Island on the boat, the day together with all of the people was very, very similar as an experience. Peter Brook, when he did the Mahabharata, did it in a quarry. He found this quarry outside of Avignon, which he adapted into a theater. And when it first opened, he arranged so that the production would end as the sun was coming up over the granite hillside. That's marvelous. People had to figure out how to get there, and they spent the night together there, having this experience together. So this sense of public communion, this uncommon sense of public communion that transforms these hundreds or thousands of atomized consumers into something else, and we could talk about what that something else is, that was the element I realized that that did link these things. And I wanted to try and think through what that was. As I got into the project, I realized that I did not want to do a history of Marathon Theater. I didn't want to do a any sort of exhaustive or comprehensive examination of everything that was long. What I really wanted to do was to look backward at some of my pinnacle experiences. I'll be honest, this book is a bit of a change of life book for me. In the year 2000, I was writing a weekly column for New York Press. I was going to the theater at least three or four nights a week. For Marvin Carlson, this is nothing, but for me, this was a lot. Going to the theater 250 or 300 times a year is frankly too much. This is a way to poison yourself to the theater. I think there's a there was a point where I was asking myself, why does an intelligent, sophisticated person stay interested in this art form, which is bad 8 out of 10 times? So I actually had a kind of a moment where I was looking inward and asked myself, okay, why do you keep going to the theater? What is the reason? What are the things that have really, really been important to you? Trying not to lie to myself. Some of the things that were most important to me were Beckett plays, which is obviously an intellectual first love for me, and that's not gonna change. But I already wrote my book on Beckett, so what else? And I realized that these marathons were really some of the more important experiences that I had had, partly for reasons that I just articulated and partly for reasons that I did not yet completely understand. And so I set out to try and understand what had happened to me on those days. Partly, I'll admit, as a way of trying to get back in touch with what was, and hopefully still is, important and necessary in the art of the theater. So let me just talk a little bit about length. We have a standard of length in the Western world. And the standard of length is actually ancient. We have a norm of length. When theater began in the Western world, it began in classical Greece. Classical Greece had a festival in Athens called the Festival of Dionysus, in which, so we think, theater went on from dawn until dusk. Even if it's not exactly dawn until dusk, it was a marathon experience because there was a tetralogy each day by another competing playwright in the festival. And this was a festival experience where people are known to have brought food and wine to sustain themselves throughout the day. They're known to have been very, very vocal. And Aristotle, in his book, The Poetics, which is written 100, 150 years after the 5th century, the time of the great playwrights, actually talks about a norm of length. And he talks about it in terms of size and order. His point is that a good play should have an organic unity. It shouldn't be like a monster that is can't be seen all in one view. He compares it to like if you can imagine a creature 1,000 miles long, you couldn't take it in a single view. That's too big. And it shouldn't be like a microscopic creature that you can't see all of either with the naked eye. It should have a unity. You should be able to see the whole and see why the whole thing makes sense. This metaphor of his, the creature 1,000 miles long that you can't see all at once, occurred to me at least a dozen times while watching Faust over that weekend, because Faust absolutely is that creature. You cannot stand anywhere where you can see the whole. Certainly when you're reading it and you have the footnotes at hand and you think, oh, I'm in an ideal position to study it, you still can't see the whole creature. This was part of the marvel of Peter Stein's production, is that it allowed spectators to understand how its parts fit together. There is, I think, something about that that is very important, even better than a reading experience. And Peter Stein was really criticized very severely by the German critics for the literalism of his production, for refusing to do anything in the staging that wasn't specifically mentioned by Goethe. And I, being an American, didn't have an investment in the Auseinandersetzung tradition, the arguing, critically arguing tradition of German directors' theater, and I was sitting there marveling at the clarity of the thing. The Germans had all, you know, read this out loud to each other during grade school, and they were thinking about the other interpretations they'd seen in their city theaters, and I'm sitting there thinking, no, I'm getting a chance to hear the whole of the text and getting a chance to understand how that part fits with that other part 2 hours earlier, which I never understood before. And the whole thing is like a room that had only been partly illuminated for me before, and all of a sudden the lights had been turned on in the room. And so I'm appreciating this whole thing, not just as a reading aid, but as a use of theater to appreciate a great poem in a way that I never could otherwise. So I think that what happened on that weekend is that this thing that almost everyone insists has no Aristotelian unity was given a kind of Aristotelian unity by a great theater man who realized that this was an experience that modern theatrical methods could now give us. And putting that together with the very moving experience of being with hundreds of Germans whose national poem this was, who were making a pilgrimage to this site, that was really an important experience for me. And I don't think it can be duplicated in America because we don't have a Faust. You know, what would we do? Get together and see Eugene O'Neill's Long Day's Journey into Night together by the hundreds, it wouldn't be the same thing. It wouldn't be the cornerstone of our national literature as this poem is. We wouldn't make a pilgrimage to it as people do. So I realized at Faust that there was something going on here with these productions that was more important even than just the single events. Something about the festival environment for the productions also, I realized, was very important. It's no coincidence that a lot of marathon theater happens in summer, in the summertime. That's when people have time to see theater that takes a day, or 2 days, or 3 days. And so festivals are often the venue that shows marathon events. There's a lot of theater festivals. I don't know if you're aware, but theater festivals have been a very, very common thing, especially since the Second World War. A lot of Western European cities have not been able to sustain themselves with industrial manufacturing, so they're in a post-industrial phase where they have to reinvent themselves, attract tourists, and so they start festivals. You know, festivals are good for their local economy, and especially in places that were devastated by the war, they have been instrumental in resuscitating the idea of Kultur or culture as a benison for mankind. But the original idea for these kinds of festivals came from Wagner. It's a 19th century idea. And the Wagner Festival, as you may know, which is dedicated only to Wagner, is that it would take place in Bayreuth, I don't know if anybody's ever been to Bayreuth. Bayreuth is where he built his festival theater. It's a rural place in Bavaria, out of the way, deliberately out of the way, off the beaten track of the cultural capitals. And this is where he wanted it. He liked the idea that people had to make a pilgrimage there, that people had to go there and have a different experience of time. They had to take themselves out of their 19th century equivalent of the rush-rush lifestyle and be in a different headspace. There's a very interesting text by Jürgen Habermas about the what he calls the medieval revival in the late 19th century in Europe. And the Bayreuth Festival is one of these items that he lists. The castle Neue Schwanstein is another. But there is a nostalgia that creeps in Western Europe, not just in Germany, but Western Europe in general in the late 19th century for the medieval, not just as a style, but as a different experience of time. And this is what these marathons, I think, created in Bayreuth. And so I think that this is, in fact, the prototype for pieces by Robert Wilson, pieces by Ariane Mnouchkine, pieces by Peter Stein that are happening 50, 75 years later without anyone ever mentioning these roots. But I do think that the roots of festivals are worth exploring, and this is part of what I discovered when I was thinking about the venues for these events. I also think that in Greece, there's something that is happening that is hard to duplicate in the modern era. And that is the investment of the public in the event in the spirit of the agora, or the public commons. The Greeks organized a lot of public institutions on the model of the theater. Their law courts and their public assembly, where they made laws, were all venues where people sat in amphitheater-type seating, listened to other people get up and make either cases for something they wanted for themselves or something they wanted for the community, and then people would vote. The theater festivals themselves were competitions in which people would vote on the winners. This idea that everyone was invested in something that was a civic responsibility as well as an entertainment gave them a tremendous personal stake in what was going on. And I think they really felt ownership of what was happening in the Festival of Dionysus and in the spirit of the drama that I think Aristotle really kind of, well, he said nothing about it in the Poetics. But it's clear that they did. It's clear that the people did, whatever Aristotle understood. It's clear that they understood that tragedy for them was an experience of shared suffering, of shared understanding of suffering in this public forum. And I think that whatever we think about tragedy, whatever we think about reinvented tragedy in the modern era, we're thinking of it through a lens of nostalgia for this moment in the ancient world when it meant so much to crowds of people that they would spend 4 days there watching plays from dawn till dusk. What would it take to get us to spend 4 consecutive days seeing plays from dawn till dusk and then voting on what was the best as if it was a civic responsibility? So this is part of what I think the makers of modern marathon theater are sometimes after. I think they are driven by a kind of a nostalgia for the type of communal involvement that is said to be impossible in the modern world, and yet they dream of it, and they try and generate it in on a spot basis, on a one-off basis, in different circumstances, in different venues. In the Middle Ages, there was another example of this. During the Middle Ages in Europe, most popular in England, there were these plays on biblical themes, Bible stories. They were called cycle plays or mystery plays, which sometimes could be several days long. There's some debate about exactly how long some of them were. But if you take the York cycle, they were played on pageant wagons. Take the York cycle. We know actually where all of the stations were in the town where it stopped. This is a particularly interesting case of marathon theater in the Middle Ages because we have diaries that tell us when it began and ended. It started at 4:30 in the morning, where the pageant wagons lined up, and then they would go and set themselves up as in each of these places, in each of these public places, there would be businesses that would provide food and drink, and they would pay a fee to be located there because it was good for business to have the crowds located there. But these plays were not done by professionals. They were done by the people in the community themselves. It was an event that was surrounds the holiday of Corpus Christi. And Corpus Christi happens in July when the weather is good. And the difference between these plays and the drama that they had seen in churches is that it was in their own languages. The church decided to allow drama done by the people in their own languages that they could understand. For the first time, what they knew was liturgical drama chanted in Latin by monks and priests in the church. And all of a sudden, they could do it themselves. And this one decision on the part of the church opened up huge floodgates of pent-up theatrical energy in the public. They put so much of themselves into these performances. This procession, one source has it going until dusk, 4:30 until dusk. Another source says that it continued until midnight under torchlight. Imagine that, 42 plays telling the story of creation from the first light uttered as a word by God till the final judgment, done by all your neighbors and your friends. The zeal behind this is another example of what I'm saying is this communal involvement that I think is an object of nostalgic fascination by theater people, even theater people who don't know anything about it. Because what we're dealing with in our own time is a receding of theater from mass popular entertainment. So I think there are two things going on with the marathons that I've studied. One is that I think they satisfy a need in busy, rushed people to create meditative experiences, kind of a slow food of theatrical art for people who are always given fast food shoved down their throat. And the other thing is that I think that they satisfy a kind of a cultural hunger that people don't know they have for communal involvement, for public communion that they can't get in other ways. So this is my introduction. This is Bayreuth Fest Spielhaus. I have a few other slides here, I'll just show you. Wagner, Mahabharata. Oh, this is a long film by Zuberberg. I was going to talk about Einstein on the Beach. So yeah, I don't want to talk too long. I think I should get John Muse up here and make this into a dialogue now, but I thought I would just show you the rest of the slides. Okay.
Welcome, everyone. First of all, thanks so much to Frank and to Jonathan for inviting me to come be here today. It's been a marathon experience for me, not just because I was here for a lot of the screening today, but because I've just flown back from Greece. I was actually at the Theater of Dionysus about 24 hours ago. and like many marathon experiences, this one has deepened as it's continued over the day, and I've been looking forward to this for a long time. The main reason I'm here is that I'm writing a book about very short plays called microdramas. The book is called Microdrama, which for me includes anything less than 20 minutes in performance, but most of my cardinal or signature examples are far shorter than that. Some of them are 2 lines long, some last 30 seconds, some last 5 minutes. They're all self-consciously short, and they're all a little bit like Jonathan, pieces that make brevity a constructive principle, that earn their short length in the same way that these marathon works earn their extraordinarily long length. We'll talk more about microdramas later, although I wanted to start by asking Jonathan a couple of questions. Following up on his presentation, and after reading his book, which is truly wonderful, and I recommend it to all of you. Jonathan, my first question was, after listening to you talk about Greek theater and about medieval mysteries, and then thinking about all of the marathon productions that you saw, I wanted to talk about the difference between the communities that those original productions were produced for and the communities that these productions are produced for, to think about the audience for contemporary marathon theater. One point you make in the book is that the 7 productions you talk about are not all for the same audience. They're actually very distinct and a wide range of people who were attracted to these pieces. And yet, nevertheless, each production, I think, appealed to a particular kind of person or to a particular set of people. And I just wanted to hear you think about for whom marathon theater appeals. Mm. And maybe as a follow-up, how much of that transformative or communal experience that you felt is a necessary product of these productions, and how much of it is sort of a conspiracy between the viewer and the piece. A conspiracy is the wrong word, a collaboration. In other words, is there a strong sense that when you go to a marathon piece, you hope that you'll have a transformative experience and that you and the production conspire together to make the experience transformative?
Hmm. Okay. I deliberately tried to, my book is called Great Lengths, 7 Works of Marathon Theater. Each of the 7 examples is deliberately chosen to be different from the others. Sometimes people have asked me why I didn't write about Mnouchkine, and it's not because I did not enjoy and have a profound experience at several of her marathon events. The real reason is because I could not think of a way to write about Mnouchkine that was really categorically different from writing about Peter Brook. It seemed as though a lot of the things that I was appreciating in that particular marathon experience were going to be duplicated in writing about Les Atrides or Dernière Caravansérée or some one of her other long pieces. So I don't think each of the audience compositions in the book are the same, and I don't think the circumstances are the same, and I don't think the reasons why each of the marathons held the audience for such a long length of time are the same in each of the cases. Faust was, from a directorial standpoint, not a world-class production. It was mind-bogglingly literal sometimes. Yet, it didn't matter, because Faust is partly an anti-theatrical text. It's working against its own theatricality for long passages, almost undermining its ability to please an audience. Because what's happening is that Mephisto is trying to fascinate Faust with all of these enticements, and the drama is about how they are not working to entice him, you know? And so think about that in terms of a dramaturgical dilemma, you know? It's about a phenomenon that happens naturally in Marlowe's Dr. Faustus, which is wow the audience with magic and then kill the guy. It's about that not happening, you know? And so the whole thing had to work on the basis of appreciating the poetry. It had to be an experience of presenting this great poem in a way that made it clear. So that's one experience. It was centralizing the language. It was 2 days of appreciating this beautiful language in a way you couldn't before. That's very different from Peter Brook, you know, where Peter Brook, you're sitting there and you're drawn in hour after hour by one after another of these incredibly inventive theatrical discoveries, you know, a baby being murdered by a cloth tossed at a pond and then just touching the water and creating ripples, you know, and that's just the first hour, and you can't believe the inventiveness of this. So it seems to me that the audience for one event is held for a whole day for a completely different reason from the audience for another event. So I don't think there's only one way of doing this, this marathon creation. And then there's something like the Nature Theater of Oklahoma, which our friend Jacob is writing about, who's in the back row here, or Forced Entertainment. These theater companies, these experimental theater companies that work with being as distinct from representing, they appeal to a very young crowd. They have a self-selected group that comes to see whatever they do because of a certain feeling that they're getting that zing of, can we call it the reality television zing, you know? And that's a certain kind of tingle that doesn't happen in Peter Brook or Peter Stein. And so that also is yet another way into the marathon experience.
Well, yeah. Just maybe to push back a little bit about that, I fully agree that the audiences are all different from each other. And yet you could say that they all share something like that quality, the audience of Nature Theater of Oklahoma, which is that you have to know about the thing and be the sort of person who would be game or up for signing a poem for a 6-hour production, a 7-hour production, an 8-hour production. And I think that brings along with it the sense of expected cultural cachet, right? That you're gonna have bragging rights after the fact from having seen this thing. And you're gonna be one of those people who has seen Gats or who has seen whatever, or seen the Devils or has seen The Great Thing. And the only question I'm asking is whether that expectation changes the experience, or maybe for some people constitutes the experience.
Do some people see these things for cachet? Sure. Are there walkouts? Yeah, there's a lot of walkouts too. People aren't, you know, averse to walking out, there are terrible marathons too, and we're not talking about those, you know, we're only talking about pinnacles here. But the I also think that if you talk to Tim Etchells or any of the Nature Theater people, they would not be offended by walkouts. They would not feel that holding people for the entire duration of the performance was a measure of anything, as I think Peter Brook would. He would be, feel that diminished his work. But when you're talking about incorporating boredom deliberately into your work, as these other companies do, you're going to get people who just don't want to be bored and go off to do something else.
Yeah, no, I fully agree. I think it's partly that I've had the sense, talking to students and other theatergoers, that there's a sort of cultured avant-garde patience, and this is sort of the flip side of cultured avant-garde impatience, right? Mm-hmm. Which I often write about, and that it sort of lays the groundwork that makes possible the paradoxical exhilaration of exhaustion that you write so beautifully about. This is admittedly, it's not really my view, it's sort of a cynic's view, and I'm curious how you would react to it. I think these
works get behind your defenses. I really do. I think when something is really caught you, when it's working for you, you're beyond this phase that you're describing about whether you're judging it from the Sunday Arts and Leisure piece last week or whether you're thinking about what your friends are going to say. Once you're pulled deeply into your own experience, which is really unusual in the theater, you're someplace else. And then you're on a journey such as you can only have with a really rare artwork. And this is the kind of thing that I'm talking about and that you're talking about. I think that you are getting at a kind of a distilled theatrical experience in the short works, which is not unrelated to what we're saying.
Yeah, it's true. We were talking earlier about the way so many of these sort of works of extraordinary length, either short or long, are trying to give the audience an experience of some kind of comprehensiveness, some kind of intensity. They're trying to package experience in a way so that Faust gives you all of the person through the story and sort of a story about everything. The mysteries give you everything from creation to the apocalypse, and very short plays often do the same thing. They're trying to collapse a long period of space or time into one moment. And I wonder whether you think something of that Mayfly effect, the sort of giving you an entire life in a day or in a 5-hour span, is built into theater.
Yeah, I do. I think that it's maybe two infusions of the same drug or two similar drugs. There is an experience of very concentrated, very enriched time. And you can have that all in 20 minutes. I think Beckett gives that to you sometimes in 16, 17 minutes. Or you can have it in 8 hours, but there is something going on in both circumstances that is about an altered experience of time. I was telling John earlier that I did a certain amount of reading on social science when I was writing my book, researching my book, which I couldn't figure out how to use. But there is a certain amount of writing about the experience of time and how time speeds up or time slows down under certain experiential circumstances. I believe that is what we're talking about somehow, and I just don't know how to apply the science to it. But if you read these books about the experience of time, they'll talk about the way that you get bored and you feel like 5 minutes is an hour when you haven't filled that 5 minutes with enough for your brain, and we can argue about what enough is. And the opposite happens, where an hour seems like 5 minutes, when the phenomena are coming faster, but it's not just a question of speed, it's a question of fullness. It's a question of fullness of experience and matching a certain kind of expectation in the brain. And so we're onto something here where I don't think either one of us has put our fingers on the parallel, but it has to do with this collapsed experience of time.
It's true. I mean, it's interesting what you said about filling time as opposed to empty time, because it seems, I absolutely agree with you. An interesting wrinkle about that, though, is that if you believe that's true, that time moves quickly when it's filled up or when you're at least distracted moment to moment by the next thing happening, and it moves slowly when there's not enough going on or when the same thing's going on for a long time, that might start to break down the equation between length and interest and brevity and triviality. In other words, that it might have less to do with how long the thing is and more to do with how it operates moment to moment. So for instance, a very long piece like the Faust we watched today actually does have a lot going on from moment to moment and fills your attention, and its beats or moments are very brief, right? And it's built on an accumulation of all of these brief moments. Whereas a play like Francesco Cangiulo's one-minute-long play Detonation, which I write about, which is a minute of silence on an empty road, followed by a gunshot, and then the curtain, feels extraordinarily long. I've recreated this production a few times for audiences, and that minute is interminable. Because you're expecting the play to happen, and there's nothing there. And so that, you know, there is a drama that unfolds in the mind of each of the spectators, but that time expands in a way, and it expands despite the fact that nothing's happening, and because of the fact that nothing's happening. But it feels very long despite being one of the shortest plays I know about. Mm. And so I wonder whether, after thinking about theatrical length, we might sort of collectively want to think about theatrical pace.
Well, I think that that's going to be easier for you to think about than in a long work. Especially if you want people to sit through it from beginning to end, which not all of the artists I discuss do. But if you want people to sit through it from beginning to end, you really have to think very carefully about pace and varying the pace. It's kind of like style in writing, where if all your sentences are really long or all your sentences are really short, people can't stop following, you know? This is one reason why we have directors, because they have a sense of pacing and they have a sense of when attention is lost and held. And I think that certainly Stein and Brook and Trevor Nunn are masters at this kind of study of pacing. When you talk about a futurist play, which is 1 minute long, you know, you're talking about something which is only going to have one pace. And so, you know, you'll have a different calculation about how it's going to grab the audience.
Right. Although, of course, this gets complicated because in almost every case, short works like that are yoked together into groups and then presented as an evening that is itself probably an hour long or 2 hours long, and doesn't really get away from the remarkable tenacity of conventional evening of theater.
Right.
One of the sort of remarkable facts lying behind your book is just how tenacious that norm is of the 2 to 3 hour evening of theater. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if you might talk a little bit more about that norm for a while.
Yeah.
Why do you think 2 to 3 hours has survived for so long, for at least since the Renaissance?
Yeah, it is fascinating. It's a very, very long-lived norm in our culture. Theater happened, it began at 2 o'clock at the Globe Theater, Shakespeare's Globe Theater, and it had to be over by 5:30 because that's when the sun went behind the walls and it was too dark to continue to play, which is how we know that you can't possibly have had an uncut Hamlet at the Globe Theater, regardless of how the text is printed in the folio. And the norm of 2 to 3 hours was sustained in Spain, in France, throughout the neoclassical era, in Germany. It's a very, very stable, long-lived convention that what's considered a full evening of theater since the 1500s has been 2 to 3 hours. I think it has to do with the idea that before the media age, people didn't have television, they didn't have movies, and there was a need, certainly as the middle class was growing, to fill the hours between the last meal of the day and bedtime. And that interval is pretty much 2 to 3 hours. That's one force behind it. But I also I also think that there's something about it. Lope de Vega said this in his essay on the new art of writing plays, that artists felt that was the limit of audience patience. Yeah. He says this in that essay, that this is how much patience people have. They have 2 to 3 hours of patience. After that, they don't have it. And so you have exceptions. There's Jesuit theater that's longer. There's always exceptions. But the norm is 2 to 3 hours throughout the bourgeois triumph in Western culture. And so it became a bourgeois norm and now an expectation, which is why when you depart from it, people are irritated and they want some justification for it, or they want the Sunday Times to warn them about it or something.
Yeah, it's funny. So Poe has an essay called The Philosophy of Composition where he writes about length, and he's talking about poetry, and he has a whole story about how he composed The Raven. And it's a sort of disingenuous story. He claims that his first question was, exactly what effect do I want to produce in the reader? And I'm going to start with intensity of effect. I want a very intense emotional effect. And then you think, okay, well, what form would I use to create that effect? And how can I find exactly the form that will produce it? And he says, it's just obvious that the intensity of the effect will be inversely proportional to the length of the thing. So that a very condensed short poem will have a stronger effect than a longer one would. and that all great, and he's actually using a logic similar to Aristotle's that you mentioned earlier, which is that you want unity of impression, right? I mean, many of the authors of very short works are driven by a sort of more radical version of Aristotle's need for unity. They just think that in order to have unity, you can only have a single gesture rather than a single evening of gestures. And Poe said that no great poem could be one that you have to read in more than one sitting. So for him, the sitting, we use this phrase frequently as if we know how long it is, one sitting. But I wonder if...
I think there's a difference between Poe saying that and a poet today saying that, because the 19th century itself, it's not quite medieval, but it did have a different relationship to time and to monumentalism. The 19th century is the century of Wagner. It's the century of Peer Gynt and gigantic serial novels that are serial and not serial that are yeah. Huge.
Multi-volume Tolstoy novels.
Yeah, and you could you could assume that this embrace of sheer size on the part of an ambitious artist would be understood in sincere and earnest terms as a positive value in that century. You know, in the wake of the bombastic monumentality of the Nazis and the communists, we have a skeptical relationship to everything that claims to be monumental, particularly in the world of the intelligentsia, artists and scholars and so on. We can't just claim that anything large is is positively inflected. It has to prove itself by dint of some sort of original vision, which is why each one of these pieces that I write about has its own challenge to justify its not just its length, but its purported monumentalism. What sort of monumentalism is not degraded yet? That's the standing question behind each of these things. What about this need that we seem to feel to experience something larger than ourselves is not degraded yet by what we know of history? This is a tough question, and it makes it harder to do this kind of work seriously and earnestly in our time. But these artists that I'm talking about risk it. They dare it. And I think they do an extraordinary job.
I wonder, so it's obvious that there are lots of long works that don't live up to the standards that you've chosen for the seven pieces you profile. Did you ever feel some tension between the sort of two subjects of your book? The one is extraordinary theatrical experiences that are the pinnacle moments, as you call them, and the other is very long plays. In other words, do those two topics overlap entirely, or they're obviously somewhat distinct? The question is, do you feel like people will read your book as a study of very long plays in general, and in doing so, miss some of the point, which is that you're writing about a particular possibility for very long plays rather than...
That's a good question. I think that my real topic is a certain class of experience.
Right.
And that people who read the book closely will see that. I think that there is a certain aspect to the marathons I describe that is like a crucible. A crucible is a vessel that is going to test the strength of what is put in it. And while I don't believe that anything is good or bad simply because it's really long, I do think that a really long piece is put in a position to show its flaws and assets much more glaringly than a normal length or a regular evening length piece of theater. And so if you're going to test out ideas, if you want to think about it as a forum for testing out your ideas, it's going to be ruthless, merciless about those ideas. It's going to show up what's wrong with them much more than you ever bargained for. And it's also, if something is really working, it's going to put it in a light that is brighter than anything else could. So that's the way I would answer that.
That's a really elegant way to put it, and it reminds me very much of something that I often say about very short plays. This is another one of these sort of surprising connections between my work and your work, which is that I often write about very short plays as tests of theatrical possibility, as works that call attention to theatrical norms and theatrical conventions by flouting them, and that raise the stakes, you might think they lower the stakes, but I think they actually raise the stakes on the theatrical event by testing just how quickly one can identify with a story or what it's possible to do in a short time. And in doing so, they become crucibles or laboratories for theatrical experience in very much the same way, or in some maybe parallel ways, you should say, to the very long pieces. So to ask that as a question, you might ask whether any deviation from standard length calls attention not just to itself, but to the operations of theater.
That's a good question.
And that's a funny question, because you started out by saying that we just assume that length is secondary, and that the artist decides on the subject and then picks the appropriate container for that subject. Container is even the wrong word, right? Makes the thing the size that it needs to be. We tend to think organically about this, right? That it grows and whatever it ends up becoming is the right length. But of course, both of us have found that in the works we study, these are works where the container itself becomes very visible, right? Where you're actually made to look at the length of the thing and the shape of the thing, and that becomes part of the content. So that it's never quite so easy to say that the thing just grew to be whatever shape it was.
Yeah, there's a pretty big flexible sense of a norm now. I think that if any of us arrived at the theater and found that something was 70 minutes or 90 minutes, we wouldn't flinch. That would be okay. Kafka's Monkey, which was just playing theater for a new audience, is 50 minutes, and people accept that too. So I think what you're talking about is something that really, really is departing severely. You say less than 20 minutes, I'm sure that would be provocative. And something that's more than 4 hours is, I think, almost always dependably provocative. But the provocation is not just in length. The provocation is beyond that. And something that just crossed my mind is how the futurist material you were citing was scandalous. And for a while, the Marathon Theater that happened in New York was pretty regularly generating scandals. That surprised me when I started to look into it. Nicholas Nickleby created a little scandal about breaking the $100 ticket barrier. The Mahabharata created a little scandal about interculturalism and whether Peter Brook was being exploitative about Indian cultural sources and so on. And I usually look at this as a side issue, as a sideshow, but I wonder if it's not maybe also in a certain way could be looked at along the lines of what you just said, which is that these works are unusual and they're stretching people's expectations, and so their discomforts are coming out in funny ways. I don't know. I could think about that more.
Yeah, I mean, you're right that they cause scandals, although another surprise of, I think, both of our stories is that they don't cause a scandal for very long, and that
it's true.
The number of years for which something can count as truly avant-garde is pretty short, so that, I write not just about the shock of brevity, but the brevity of shock. The 15-minute plays that floored Strindberg when he read them in the 1880s were no longer that surprising at all when they'd become the standard grand guignol fare that the futurists were reacting against, right? When they wrote 2-minute plays or 1-minute plays, and 15 minutes might seem long to the audiences of neo-futurist plays in Chicago where they performed 30 plays in 60 minutes. All of that raises a question for me, which is how much are conventions about length historically specific, and how much are they transhistorical? Because it seems like at times you want to say, and I agree, I also want to say, that something of what an audience in Athens was getting is similar to what an audience in York was getting, and similar to what an audience in Hanover was getting from the experience of a day at the theater. And at the same time, part of your argument is saying that these 20th century marathons are emerging from and in reaction against a media age, right? An age that takes for granted that entertainment should be fast and should be at our disposal, that we're not subject to it, we choose when it starts and ends. It's an almost impossible question to answer, but I wonder if you feel like any smart statement about theatrical length has to be put in historical context, or are there also maxims that could hold across time?
I don't know if they could hold across time. I wouldn't presume to guess. But I would say that we live in a very interesting moment when people like the artists, some of the artists I'm talking about, Pavelishka included, Tim Etchells, even to a certain extent, Peter Brook, would answer you in a different way. I think they would turn the question around and ask whether we're not especially privileged in our time to look at life as a kind of theater, to blend these two lenses together, what we think of as this is impossible for us as theater scholars to be pure about, because we're always thinking about this. We're always thinking about the performative and everything. We look at people on the street and think about the theatricality of everyday life. But I think that what each of these artists would say is that that is actually an aspect of our time, that there is a kind of acceptance of the theatricality of everyday life, which is getting people to look differently at the duration of a day and what happens to them in that day, whether it's because they watch so much TV that they're comparing themselves to their favorite TV characters, or something more sophisticated. So I think that it's deeply embedded in its historical moment, the way that marathon theater can be justified and polished. But as to whether that's transhistorical, I don't know.
Yeah, so, could we take some questions?
Yeah, let's talk about time. Maybe it's time to go to some questions. And again, we will have a microphone. Maybe Forrest, you can put on some light for the audience. And maybe you put the arms up and once we just count. One, two, three.
The article I read in the theater review has been very much on my mind. It's about the productions of Ibsen in Europe. The director's name, or what his name escapes me right now, but what they do, I think it's a partnership. They take plays of Ibsen and they blow them up into marathon proportions and then do all kinds of anarchic, sometimes violent, audience-provoking experiments. And it's in terms of a marathon, it would seem like an experience for the audience that would be of a different order than the one you're describing, Jonathan.
I don't know the artist.
It's in a theater. The one that comes out of Yale.
The style is sort of a cross between Paul McCartney's work and also compared to Viennese actionism. It's very sort of surreal masks. They're sort of trying to embody the subtextual elements of the pieces rather than delivering the text as much.
Yeah, I also can't remember.
I can't remember
the name of the artist, but Andrew Friedman, who's here at CUNY, wrote the article.
Oh, yeah.
And so I'm a little bit surprised that he hasn't already called you to talk to you about it.
What's the name of the artist?
Benga Nula. Yeah, Wenger and Mueller.
Wenger and Mueller, thank you for reminding me. It's interesting, sort of as a counterpoint to Stein, because it's very much in the director's theater tradition where they're self-consciously pushing against the assumption that you should just be presenting the piece, and so director will stay in the space for 24 hours and urinate and defecate in the space rather than leaving it. And so
the audience members can pay 100 euros to urinate on an actor.
There's
you cut off Norris's head.
The predictable scandal, or the compulsory avant-garde aspect of a lot of German theatrical production that you write about is there, but it's very much at the discretion of the director. People are also invited to leave and come back.
Of course.
So there's a sense that it's not important which moment you're seeing. Anyway.
I guess I don't think that the German context is comparable to other contexts. It's not just actionism. It goes back to Joseph Beuys, who spent 24 hours once with a pile of margarine, leaning his head on it and smearing it on his back of his knees and so on. And there's a long tradition of what you might call negative endurance in the German tradition. I guess I don't think that travels so well.
Well, they're very well and popular in Norway right now.
Really?
They had their main stage Norway. Subsidized.
Well, I'm going to look it up. Hmm?
I played in Germany also. Hmm. Jonathan, you made an interesting comment that I'd like for you to elaborate on. And that is that the aspect of duration, because that's what we're talking about when we're talking about time, not mechanical time, but the sense of duration, that it has to do with what is filled into that duration, how we feel about it, how we perceive what's going on, whether we perceive it as being very dense and fast, regardless of the mechanical length, or as being very extended and empty. And I was thinking, it's a very, do we have now this need to fill with quantities of activity and action every moment, which is in a way in contradistinction to, let's say, the idea of the empty canvas, where you stand in front of the empty canvas, or even White on White by Malevich in the early part of the 20th century, where he calls to the attention the fact that it's what the onlooker brings to the event or to the canvas that matters ultimately more. And in the case of the Peter Stein production, which is full of Goethe's words, which is mostly what it is, versus Mahabharata, which is full of visual imagery, but in both cases it's filled to the hilt. So the aspect of do we need to overlay more on those words to perceive something as being important? That's to me an interesting question, this whole question of filling the time, the need to fill. Why?
As I said before, I think that the artists I write about take radically different attitudes toward that question. Sure, Stein felt he needed to fill the time, the intervals, and I think that the forced entertainment does not feel an obligation to absolutely fill every single part of its temporal canvas. I think that there's a different attitude toward that. You've got a long tradition of performance art which leaves a lot of the durational canvas empty, so that the audience will bring its own experience more actively to it. My feeling is that the audience always does that, is always bringing its own experience to it. This this kind of avant-garde age trope of expecting the audience to complete the work is, to me, a little bit of a, it's overdone, I think, because there really is no great artwork of which that's not true.
So as I listen to you both talk, I'm thinking about the sort of distinction between emotional impact of a piece and intellectual impact of a piece. And I'm wondering, you know, people like Brecht or Shklovsky, and I'm wondering if of the two genres you're both talking about, one perhaps is more appeals more to the emotions, and do microdramas appeal more to have more of a stimulatory effect on the intellect, or is that completely false?
I think from my perspective, that's an absolutely accurate statement, at least if you limit it to the microdramas I discussed, which are sort of self-consciously provocative and aesthetically dense and educated rather than sort of, you know, not every television commercial might fit the bill. But that isn't to say that every short work is intellectually challenging. I think it is to say that short works make clear how difficult it is to have an effective impact in a short period of time. And that I think that they make clear the affective underpinnings of normative full length. Right? I think it's more than the historical coincidence that people finished work at one time and went to bed at another that lie behind a two-hour length, right? It's also that there's something that feels satisfying about a certain set of experiences that, right, that reach their climax in some very long productions where you feel like you've totally been immersed into another world. But something like that happens with any fictional story you read or hear or listen to, right, where you're becoming involved in world building, and that emotionally, it's just very difficult to do that in fewer than 10 minutes, unless you do a lot of shortcuts, right? I mean, a story about a starving child will affect a parent very quickly, or could, right? So there's lots of examples you could think of about shortcuts. But in general, it's hard to make someone care quickly. As a result, the artists who write very short pieces are sort of left with a twist to the intellect, right, with making some sort of point or a joke or a revelation, but it tends for the most part to be a flash. There are plenty of cases where the flash is emotional when it comes at the end of a longer piece and has a more gradual buildup. But I wonder if you feel the same way.
I would answer the question another way. I think that there's an ideology behind choices about balance of the head and the heart in a lot of theater. There's an ideology to futurism, which is a violent destructiveness. One of the elephants in the room that we haven't talked about is the Gesamtkunstwerk, the Wagnerian ideal of the total artwork, which was itself a kind of monumental ideal, which involved in Wagner's iteration, a huge envelopment in emotion, a kind of a tranquilizing or hypnotizing effect, which has kind of creepy undertones, you know, when you think about it historically, especially when you think about how much the Nazis liked Wagner and liked to hang out in Bayreuth. So this kind of dominating the audience patriarchal model of the Gesamtkunstwerk, dominated by emotion, is something that I think artists have to be wary about in the late 20th century, early 21st century. I don't know if they have to go down Brecht's road, but they have to do something like that in order to add some sort of conscious consideration of to the hypnotic effect, because the hypnotic effect, the total emotion investment, is not going to fly and is going to be attacked. So
maybe one last question, if there is one.
Well, thank you all for coming. It's been a delight.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.